All right, hello all my friends and welcome back to Victor's channel. If you've been here before, thank you and welcome for stopping back in. If this is your first time, I hope you enjoy it and I hope you do come back. This is a video I've been requested to react to a few times and I've really had a lot of interest in it. And the title is Eating with the World's Most Isolated Tribe, the Tree People of Papua, Indonesia. And I do realize that this is just one of many tribes. And not many people will be eating this way on a regular basis in Indonesia. I completely understand that. I just want to point out that I realized that from the start. But each tribe has their own slightly or even very different culture and customs. And there's so many different tribes with so much diversity in Indonesia. I'd like to see and learn as much as I can about everyone, which is impossible. You know, looking at this opening scene, I see there's a dead tree and some machetes, and I imagine we're going to be eating some grubs. I've never tried grubs. Let me know if you have. I'm not sure if I could, because I have this thing about textures and food, and I'm not sure if I would really enjoy a grub popping in my mouth. But they might be good. I'd probably give one a go, give it a try at least once, and then we'd see. But let me know if you've ever tried them. Or just leave me an emoji. Let me know your opinion or any other comment or suggestions that you might have. And please like and subscribe because it really helps a lot. So without any more rambling by me, Eating with the World's Most Isolated Tribe with the Best Ever Food Review Show.
Oh, holy shit.
Oh, that's pretty. The Korowai Tribe.
West Papua is home to over 300 different tribes, including one of the most isolated tribes in the world.
How often are they being visited?
This is not like a touristic spot. They live in the jungle and then moving nomad life.
Four flights, a two-hour drive, and miles of trekking through the rainforest has brought me here.
Whoa.
Famous for their homes high in the trees, the Korowai people live and eat different from any place I've seen on Earth.
This is the way how we survive in the jungle.
Oh!
Today, I'll be making contact.
How do I say hello?
Following in their footsteps.
They just saw something in the woods here.
And living the life of the Korowai people. I've been doing this now for over 3 years. Dozens of countries, hundreds of videos, and this is undoubtedly the most difficult and arduous journey I've undertaken.
Yeah, watch your steps.
The long, shaky flights, sharing hotel rooms with a gang of roaches, and this seemingly unending trudge into the rainforest. It's all in the pursuit of documenting the world's most unique food, and something tells me I'm not gonna be disappointed.
Trying to look cool, did it work?
This region has experienced days of relentless rainfall, more than usual. It looks beautiful, but one wrong step, one twisted ankle, and it could take days to reach proper facilities.
We are on our way to the Korowai people, and it is no joke right here. There used to be a log, but it has fallen down. Oh, it's way too early to get my feet wet, man. It's never gonna be dry.
It looked wet already.
There is a current though, guys.
Well, the other guy's carrying his shoes for him. Now he ought to be carrying his own shoes.
So, you gotta lean into it a little bit.
Cool.
Done. Huh?
The guy without a stick was carrying his shoes.
No big deal. All right, they were here half an hour ago.
Ideally, you've got feet with some callus built up so you can just feel your way through the water. Instead, I just got these on. So I'm trying to not get water in my shoe.
They've got water in them.
At all. It's hilarious.
The Korowai thought they were alone in the world until 40 years ago when first contact was made. Now, many Korowai have been drawn to a modern lifestyle, trading in tree houses for homes and villages outside the rainforest. But some still live today as they did hundreds of years ago.
At this point, my biggest question is what do you enjoy eating? What is your favorite food out here? Is it just about staying alive, or is there some food that's the treasured food?
Today, there are only 3,000 Korowai in Papua.
Wow.
What you are about to witness has never before been documented on video.
Wow.
It's the big guy.
The big chief come to pick us up.
Ah, how do I say hello?
Kotre.
Kotre. Kotre. Kotre. How far is the village from here?
Almost 20 minutes.
Are you hunting?
He said, before I used to kill the enemy, but now I just come here to pick you up, not for killing you.
For self-defense.
Yeah.
Well, I want to say thank you so much for allowing us into your village.
smoother.
And lastly, I brought some cigarettes in case you smoke. Do you smoke Marlboros?
Oh, so that's the way you do. You have to bribe them with some cigarettes. That's kind of funny.
This is a traditional Kauai treehouse.
That is so cool. I wonder, do they do that because there's a lot of flooding, or is it protection, or is it both? I'd imagine it's probably both. But I wouldn't think it would flood that deep there. Maybe it does.
One side is dedicated to the women, and the other side to the men. Amazingly, at any given time, there are two fires burning inside the house. Cooking is done exclusively in the home.
We're under the treehouse right now. It's still raining, super muddy, but we're still gonna go hunt. How often are you successful?
Sometimes they get it, and sometimes they lose.
So when you don't get anything, what do you eat?
They mostly eat in sagu. It's a staple food for Warawai people.
Besides being their staple food, sago wood is also used to construct the floor, walls, and roofs of each home.
Wow. Where does it get the metal?
From the missionary gave them for tools at home, and then they use it for...
Wow.
Is this usually the way you're hunting, with a bow and arrow?
Yeah.
The Korowai chief will let us join their hunt, but only if we can keep up. The dinner menu is dependent upon what crosses their path during the hunt. Jungle rats, giant insects, or even tree kangaroos are all possibilities.
They're gonna eat whatever they see.
A bow and arrow for the kill, and a dog to sound off when prey is near.
Oh, they got a little dog.
Even with the hunting dog, they have to wait for the dog to alert them, and then they can actually hunt it with flipping arrows. So we've trekked for about 30 minutes now back into the jungle, away from their home, like even deeper from where we started. We might have to go even deeper into the super lush, thick jungle to actually catch something.
Your average city dweller would starve to death after a few days here. But for the Korowai, food is everywhere.
This is the top of the palm tree. When I had coconut worms in Vietnam, I found you could eat the same thing like the coconut worms do. Eat the very inside of the tree. It's very fibrous and watery. And it looks like that's what's gonna happen here. Kind of peeling the palm into... That was his portion. This is the really thick, fibrous portion right here. And then here, I don't know. It kind of flowers up into this. Looks like a mop. I'm just gonna try it out. Oh, it's like a mushroom. I mean, the texture. Not a strong flavor, just kind of watery and like a nice mushroomy kind of texture. Wow, that's cool.
After a couple miles of rough terrain, it looks like mammals will not be gracing our dinner plates tonight. But that doesn't mean we won't be eating well.
Right here, guys, is a sago tree. So they harvested part of it in the past, and now they're looking for sago grubs. Oh my God, he looks pumped. Oh God, I don't like bugs.
What?
This is the worm? What, I thought it would be way bigger. In Vietnam, they're eating the coconut worms. It becomes a coconut weevil. They don't eat the adult form in Vietnam, but here they're like, fuck, I mean, why not? They don't eat it alive. Maybe because it's a pain in the ass. I think he's just gonna squeeze the head. Can you?
Oh.
He just kind of rolled the head until it's just, it's asleep now.
Oh
my God. Look how many worms.
Yeah,
they've
already harvested
like half this tree. After it's been sitting in the rain and kind of rotting, they come back and they look for beetles and worms and whatever else could be in there. But it has that sour, yeasty, fermented sago smell to it. And the worms, they love that.
This is a special fern tree growing in the wild rainforest in the Korowai. When they're hunting, they take this also.
But will they eat this?
Yes.
Oh, they will.
We will eat
this. This can be eaten.
Yeah.
With all their raw ingredients in hand, we head back to the treehouse to start preparing dinner.
You know, I've heard, you know, in ferns, you've got the called fiddleheads, and I've heard ferns were pretty well good. I haven't ever ate them. I know a lot of people, when I lived in South Carolina, would eat fiddleheads.
Believe it or not, we're actually up in a treehouse right now, and right here they're making this splendid meal.
This is today's main dish, using ingredients caught from and found in the surrounding rainforest. It starts with a layer of dry sago tree starch, then a sprinkling of pica, a type of edible clay material.
It tastes like clay.
Oh yeah, sure.
Dry sand.
The practice of eating earth or soil-like substances is nearly universal around the world in tribal and traditional rural societies. Clay minerals have beneficial microbial effects, protecting the stomach against toxins, parasites, and pathogens.
And then they're putting on the fern, then they put on all the sago worms from the tree, and then all this kind of fern right here.
Yes.
And then more on top. So this is kind of like a giant cake or something.
Giant pizza or something.
Okay. You're going to put all these super hot rocks on here. Now they're going to bundle all these leaves. It's like its own self-contained oven. And all of this is just stuff they caught and collected from right around here.
Yeah,
so cool.
Oh, I like how they cooked that. Bundling it with the hot rocks.
45, 35 minutes on the fire, and then we're going to bust that open and eat it.
What is that?
You said the dry one. You will try.
What? The dry what? Oh, no. It's a sago worm.
The sago worms that didn't make it into the main dish are put directly onto the fire and treated as an appetizer of sorts.
Smoky. Kind of tastes like grilled chicken. I think as it's like singed, it's a little like charcoal flavor.
Yeah, I've saw, you know, some cultures, they eat them raw. And that's what I was talking about with the texture. Actually, I think they would be a lot better cooked. Those might be all right. Cooked skin, if anything, tastes good. I ain't gonna say
like
anything.
Sounds like they're murdering a pig now. They're not. Turn it off.
Throw it off.
Oh. Coming up next, you thought that was it, but what about the beetles from today? They're right here.
The beetles we caught earlier from the same sago tree were dispatched for easier transport.
Oh, sorry.
You're dead. We're going to eat you for dinner.
All of them are dumped onto the hot cinders to cook through.
Cheers. Oh, it just tastes like soot from the fire. I mean, it's on there. It's like a little bitter.
Can I get you one?
Yeah. Not bad. That's pretty good. Don't fall in the fire. Okay, I was helping you. He's like, I got it. I'm already two, I'm fine. Boom, oh! So this is finished cooking. We're all gonna join together, and I don't know which way we're bringing it. I'll get right here. They kind of cook everything this way, whether they've got some pork or some tree kangaroo. Wow, look at that. That vibrant red-orange color is from the sago. It looks kind of like a pizza, except for this pizza has worms in it. Oh, it's super hot, but he's ripping it apart with his hands. She says, no, use this, be smart. And he says, yes, I agree, that is a good idea. Oh, and then this is how they prepare it. This is like one serving right here. Thank you.
After a portion of sago pizza is handed to each housemate, they retreat into their own personal space to eat.
Inside, oh, big sago reveal. That fern that we saw in the jungle earlier has kind of cooked down. It's kind of a mush. And then that is mixed with all the sago. And then there's just little chunks of worm throughout. I don't know. Everyone just kind of rips it up and eats pieces. I'm going to try it. This is sick, yo. This is so good. This is so weird. It's become this really gummy, chewy texture. And then the greens, the ferns have broke down. They're soft now. Earthy and grassy. It tastes like the jungle. It's about what you would expect. I mean, look at that. There's a giant sago worm right there in my next bite. Man, you really gotta chew the heck out of it, though. That is out there, man. I must say, this is one of the most special moments of my life. Being so far away, a place we had to trek hours to through the rain, to finally being in this treehouse, their home, where they have a fire inside, they're cooking food that we caught today. It's so refreshing. It's so cool to see something.
How do they, I wonder, keep the fire from burning through the bottom of the floor? Is it just have a bunch of rocks piled up underneath the fire and they hope that coals don't drop down?
This new, this different, it's beautiful. I love it. And it really, I don't know. It tastes like the jungle. Got a little bit of everything in there. Little sago, little worm, little greens, and that's Papua in a pizza.
Every once in a while, it's good to get a reminder of just how soft I am. The real world for me consists of cameras, computers, and YouTube. The real world here consists of the real world. Using ancient knowledge, passed down from generation to generation, not through books or blogs, but through daily practice. Through my eyes, these rainforests are daunting and overwhelming. Where I see an endless list of potential hazards, the Korowai see food. They see medicine. They see tools. They see hope. And a decade from now, when the apocalypse has wiped out most of the Earth, when humanity is reduced to strangers battling over the last can of beans at a Walmart, the Korowai will be doing just fine. From researching and shooting to editing and mastering, our 10-person Best Ever Food Review Show team works hard to roll out the highest quality travel food entertainment twice a week. If you like what we do here, please consider supporting our Patreon. Patreon allows fans of the show to contribute a monthly sum and receive a load of extras, like early video
releases.
Yeah, I think
the rest of this is going to be Patreon.
To learn more about our Patreon, check out the link in the description box down below. And if you can't give or don't even feel like it, that's okay too. We're just happy you're here. Guys, thank you so much for watching. That has been Pop War. I will see you next time. Peace. Hey, we got proof. Yeah.
Before you.
All right, there we go. With the best ever food review show. I know he's got several other videos, tribal videos that he eats with. And I'm going to try to react to all of them. Because I really enjoy his content. We only really saw one meal there that wasn't, you know, we didn't get to see a tree kangaroo or a spider or jungle rat or anything. So, you know, I'd like to see some of those. Let me know what you think. Please like and subscribe if you haven't already. And have a great day. And please stay safe wherever you are. And don't forget to be kind. Thank you. Goodbye.